Hello guys, here I'm again, back on the Qproud server, and I've got some updates for you. I've been building once again on stream quite a lot, and I've finished many projects I want to show you now. So here we are at my base. Obviously, we've already seen this before, where we can walk inside through the main building. Nothing changed except that the creeper blew up here and I had to rebuild everything over the bridge. And last time we checked out this part, it was, well, it was a construction site, and right now, by now, it's almost completely done. So this is the entrance, completely new entrance, some grass on the ground, nice walkways. We go inside, and to the right side we immediately have the enchanting room with the enchanting table, the anvil, ender chest, everything you could need, and some chests for books and lapis and XP bottles I got somewhere, and a bed. This is my sleeping place right now, alongside the bed in the other room. Yeah, I decorated all of them. I left the ice streams at the top because I think they're pretty cool. You can hear water flowing around. Same style as always. Pretty cornered everywhere. It's quite small, you know. It looks pretty small. We go through this narrow walkway, but it always has a high ceiling, and I added these beams that go above with fences into this room, which is the smelting area, and this actually, in my opinion, turned out really nicely. Here we have fully automatic furnace array, which we can test. We throw the stone in here. We're gonna hear some clicking. You also hear, see pulsing, and then they are in here. Get put into these chests, and as you can see, I've been smelting quite a bit. One issue I couldn't resolve that easily, especially in the limited space, is that if I put items in there, obviously the entire hopper behind this furnace will fill up first before it uses the second furnace, so it's actually quite slow. I tried to put an item in there that does not get put into the furnace top. There is none. At the back of the furnace it works, so I put, I think I put, what did I put in there, like leather or something? I'm not quite sure. In order to only have one slot in the hopper filled up with coal, so the coal gets distributed evenly. That worked pretty well. And there's a stone brick. Okay. So yeah, if you have any item that is obtainable, obviously, that does not get put in here, let me know. I don't think there's any. So I will have to do with this, and I mean, it's working. You know, and if I put large amounts of in there, it's also gonna work. So yeah, looking around, here we have the windows, there's the other room, another ender chest with my items in there. This is the chest for the coal. Pretty hidden, but I like the position of it. Another anvil, obviously you need an anvil in this. And temporary chest, where I built a small rail duper that is gone now. And tons of enderpearls I just have here. This is my storage area. I actually designed on this for quite a while, because I wasn't quite sure how I wanna do it. And I've also torn it down quite a bit. Everything I did here, I streamed. So if you wanna check it out, how exactly I did it, just watch the stream. And I ended up having this, which also houses quite some chests, so I have lots of storage space for now. This is not going to be the final storage room, it's just going to be some temporary random storage thing. As you can see, there's a bunch of random chests. They are somewhat sorted. Here's the redstone chest, dirt, stone, other stone, wooden stuff, and clay, terracotta it's called now, and like wooden fabricated stuff, some bird, some yogurt in there, whatever, food. So I ended up going for stone brick style here, and actually I think it ended up really nicely. It looks pretty cool. It has some accents with spruce wood up there, lighting everywhere, and it spreads into the room a bit. Also on top, and goes over to the mossy grown over part. We have some bookshelves here, another pretty narrow walkway with another overhead beam. I actually like these quite a lot. We get into the panel we already know, but everything is decorated now. Except down there. I'm gonna have to see how I wanna do it, because down there is the railway, and I'm not quite sure how I wanna do it. But I also decorated this corner, there's a little flower, there's lighting in this, spotlight, another plant. I actually really like this corner, it looks, and I have a creeper face meshed into there, which also looks pretty cool, I think. I actually really like this corner, it ended up really nicely in my opinion. And obviously the panel that we already know. I hit a water source here, and some trapdoors in the floor. Some for lighting, just some just for looks, because I actually think they add some quite some structure to it. The panel, I don't think much will come because I haven't been here much. Let's press it though. It's lagging a bit. Oh, mushroom has arrived. Melons have arrived. Pumpkins. Brown mushrooms. Yeah, I wasn't expecting sugarcane to come because I'm constantly harvesting them. Since I got my very own elytra and full diamond gear now, as opposed to last episode. With mending, I'm breaking on it, and I'm crafting lots of fireworks at the moment, and that's why I'm needing gunpowder and lots of sugarcane that this farm actually cannot provide enough of, which is kind of an issue, but for now I still have some storage. I'm also using the elytra a lot, which burns a lot of fireworks, obviously. Another little garden here that you can't enter. I might actually want to add a fence gate here or something. Let's do it right now, actually. I want a fence gate. We have some wood. I have wood. If you're wondering how I got to all that wood, here we go. Now it's going off. This should be the fence gate. This is the fence gate. Can I turn off the thunder? Music and sounds. Weather. Yes, thank you. Gonna edit. Oh no! I broke the grass. Right here. I think I have some more in my chest. I have a flower. And grass. Here we go. When I was preparing to decorate this. Yeah, the books. I don't need the flower. Oh, those fence gates will also enter the little garden. Behind this is the wiring for the mushroom farm that goes up. I showed you last episode. And here's the second exit that leads to nothing right now, but it's also nicely decorated. Gonna try to look in F5 a bit so you can see it. Same style, very overgrown. Some windows where you can see the dispensers and light. Same here. And keeping it wooden. Yeah. What I have not covered up yet is the backside, where the wiring of the panel is in. Jesus Christ, riders! That's what the insanely loud lightning was. Oh my god, okay, that's actually quite scary. Hello? Who shot at me? What? Where's the other one? There. Fool. And the third one dropped. Oh well, got rid of two at least. Putting this back, the plant. Yeah, also here, decorated it nicely. The corner, another spotlight, iron block accents, some flowers and flower pots, and all the ice creams at the ceiling. I have to eat something now. Yeah, and this is the update to this place. Also look from above. I added lighting to all the trees. We can probably nicely see now during night. I put some redstone lamps in there. And this is how it looks from the outside. Hold on. This is the other side. I'm pretty happy with it. Looks very nice. Okay, let's get up, 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 and check out the next build. Now we shall enter the hole that is here right now, just gaping open, and where there's nothing much here. I dug this out on purpose like this, in order to, like, it needs to be that deep. I'm not sure how to decorate it though, and make it passable properly. I'm gonna have to see, not quite doing that yet. And it leads down to a railway. This got flooded, so it's pretty temporary. That's also not at all done. That leads to Bernie, another Zipcode member. Some of you might know him. And we go into this intersection I built. I actually designed, and where we can switch directions. This leads back to my other arc, but it's a shorter way, so I wanted to show you that to you. Going back, and Now if you press nothing, we go straight past our chicken farm. Let me get out. That uses the daylight sensor design to have the chickens not burn, to make it almost lossless. It seems to have glitched out though. It needs to be like this. So now it should dispense the lava. Got some lighting. It's making quite a bit of chicken. I'm also eating a lot. I took like tons of stacks here away yesterday anyway, because we were building something else. Yeah, it's a chicken farm. This leads to Bernie. I'm gonna show that off. And if you go back, the interesting part about this railway is the default is always straight, as you can see. If we leave again, go back. Oh, we also have minecart sounds again. You go straight again. So in order to go left, you need to press this. Yeah, it's a pretty simple design. We're gonna go back here so we can check it out. I had a few designs built in the creative world. If we just dig in here, but this is the one I settled with. Basically, how do I do this? Since my issues were, these are very close to the intersection, so the signal needs to be fast. I can't have tons of repeaters down there, because it will just switch the rail too slowly. So what I did, I obviously used an observer here that goes into a redstone dust behind this here. But since this would only give a one-tick pulse to the piston, the block would stay there, so I'm extending the pulse a little bit with this repeater to make it a two-tick pulse. And so the piston rejects the redstone block again. We have a little pulse length down here, so we actually can pass the intersection when you pass over. So if you flick this, this will stand on for a while. And deliver the signal down here to this repeater, into this repeater that actually locks this one. Yeah, because this is the special part of the intersection. All the other ones are pretty standard. If you flick it, it just goes into redstone torch. Flick it, redstone torch. But I have two important mechanisms in here. Firstly, this rail, detector rail, because I always want to have the standard to be straight. This detector rail, by default, will switch the rail when you pass over it. Now, if you press the button, it will go into the repeater and lock it. So you need to do it before, obviously, before you pass the detector rail, but that is pretty possible since when you're like here, you can press it, and if this is activated, this will not trigger the rail, as you can see now. If it is not activated, it will trigger the intersection. So that's what I did to lock the standard path in the straight line. And yeah, it's working pretty well. My main issue was to have this really quick. So all I have is 2 ticks delay to activate it, one through this comparator and one through this repeater. And if it was much slower, it would be unreliable. So you would have to click it really early, like as soon as you can, you would have to spam your button in order for it to work properly. But like this, it's working really well. Unless the server is lagging badly, but it's barely happening. So yeah, this is the connecting railway intersection we have down here. We're gonna build that out as well, not now, on stream, as I said. Getting up again. So after just having left my base, we are off to spawn. As we can see, there's the iron farm I showed you last video. We're gonna fly quickly below it, and because this is not what we wanna look at. But we want to look at this. So what this is as you can see, there's a big sign of wood in the air. And this is a fully automatic wood farm designed by Trex, Max is Cool, and me. None of them are online, I think, right now. No. And it's inspired by Mango's design, with the two sides of the pushers that can push wood into the TNT. But however, in comparison to his design, this is completely spam-proof, because we actually managed to break his design while spamming it. And we also designed it from scratch. So we just took the concept and tried to make something new with it, and we succeeded completely. So what this is. Obviously, it's a wood farm that pushes the wood once it's full into a TNT that will get duped by a TNT duper up there. And as long as this block is in motion by the piston, the wooden block, it loses all its blast resistance, and due to it having zero blast resistance, all the items will drop, and also many, many blocks will break. So this entire wall will break as soon as it reaches this TNT, which is up there. And it's really efficient, really fast, and fully automatic. So yeah, let's take a look at it from the inside. We go through the maintenance entrance, and basically what happens is, we go up here. As soon as this is full, all these will push forward, obviously. Standard wooden farm design. However, if we get any holes like this, and an item lands in there, and the entire wall just pushes forward, the items will still be stuck in there, and will get destroyed by the TNT. So to prevent that, what we have done here is a zero tick pulse, because this and this activate at the same time. Interestingly though, you can swap those. So you can have the comparator here and the repeater here. You cannot use comparator and repeater comparator and repeater repeater though. This doesn't work. It needs to be either or. It's just Minecraft, I guess. So the pulse gets shortened so much because both of these activate and the block gets pushed away from this repeater that it's a zero tick. It's so short that despite this piston technically being butt powered by this redstone line in this block, it does not extend. So once this gets triggered, only the most upper part extends. You can probably see that if I put a block in there. You probably could see it pretty well. I'm gonna put another one and stand up here. Oops, not like that. Oh, now we have the TNT. Nothing is gonna go off much because there's nothing to push. Well, anyway, let's place another block. First, second, third, both, and then again. Because, since, how do we get up there, like here. Since there's another repeater here with the three tick delay, this pulse is in fact long enough to have the butt take effect and push both. So first, second, push, then we have the same copy down here again. So only this pushes, then this pushes, and this is just normal push since there's nothing below it. So it doesn't need to be fancy. The other mechanism that is in this is a brilliant idea by Trax, and it's a belt of glass blocks and one observer. And this observer, every three rounds, so every third time this is full, will reach this redstone line. It's this observer actually. Will reach this this redstone line to power a big delay, power the TNT, and one big push that pushes all of them through in order to push them into the TNT and have them blow up. And we can test the farm. Let's close this, go in here. Activate it, take some saplings. Somebody has been getting birch wood with this. Good for them. I want to have oak wood though. So we push, push, push. Once it's full, we will hear that on the right side. As you can hear, the mechanism. Keep planting, keep planting. And it always returns more saplings than we are using. And I think it's still on, yes. So this is a mechanism, every time a tree grows, this will dispense... Oh. There we heard it. Every time a tree grows, this will dispense one sapling to me in order to always keep me stocked up in case I want to AFK here. So we're gonna have one more go, because I want to show you something really important with this design that also was really important to us, and that is the spam proofness of it. We have yet to manage to actually somehow make it break. It hasn't happened yet, so I think it's pretty clear, safe to say, it's pretty stable. And I'm gonna show you how we do it once we get to the TNT part again. Having it grow, more. Second push commencing now. It's going. This tree is taking its time. Should be pretty soon. Oops. Yeah, we also have enough bone meal. Yeah, the only resource this farm obviously takes is bone meal, since you always get enough saplings back. Oh yeah, and now we have the case, where the farm would be stuck if it wasn't for two clever mechanisms we have installed. Let's turn both off again and store the saplings. Firstly, every time the entire push gets triggered, this torch also gets disabled by this piston here. This goes in here, activates this repeater, this torch, and this powers redstone line you saw above. This is just a standard Zipkraut Panda tree farm, which always returns enough saplings, pretty standard here. And the second mechanism we're having is if we walk around, and this is full, technically this pusher should also occupy. But what we did here is add a clock to it, a very fast comparator clock, that if this is full, you can just, let me just occupy, or make this not working, there we go. Let me get the piston, and let's just fill it up again so we can actually see it in action. Turn it on, have it dispense all the items. It's like 7 pushes we're having. Now it's stuck. So, first, what I just showed you, since this keeps pulsing back and forth, this also keeps turning off and on and triggering the redstone line, which actually makes this pulse. So this farm will constantly try to push, as you can see, it's constantly trying. As well as, let me just get through here, this pusher is also constantly trying. You see the piston? It constantly pulses, and if we now go and unoccupy it, oops, that was the wrong orientation, like this, as you can see it goes one by one. Let's close this off again. This one has been cleared again, fully operational, as well as the wood farm having pushed out too. As you can see, planting area completely free. We have here, as I said, we have yet to crash it. It seems really, really stable. Perfect design. Thanks a lot to Trex and Maxis for, yeah, helping me build this, designing it from scratch. We couldn't be happier with it. Alright, and venturing through the Nether towards the end, actually, we get to this sign, the Future Public Mob Farm, which Maxis Cool is building, actually. And all of a sudden, by now, as you can see, Maxis, he has built a giant perimeter. It's actually definished. And he is plastering it all with melons, because this is a snow biome, so just putting it on water wouldn't work, everything would freeze, and then we would have an issue. So, yeah. He is putting melons everywhere, and not half steps because melons are cooler, I guess, yeah. And he did it by having TNT duper flying machines flying over here, and therefore like the walls are pretty rugged. But what I'm coming here for is actually this year. My new project, together with a few other members. And what we're doing here is, we are building a guardian farm. And as you might be wondering, why the hell is this temple underground? It's actually pretty cool. We just drained it, we just got done with it actually. And now we're ripping it down to start building the farm. And yeah, it's underground simply because this world generation is completely custom, as I showed you last episode. And temples get
apparently get generated after, like as you can see, we're in the forest here. Up there on the biome list, we're in the forest, and there's a temple here, and they do that everywhere. Like there's temples underground everywhere. It's actually pretty cool, and yeah. Bye bye, Drex. Oh, they're targeting him. Yeah, that's pretty cool. So we just drained it, and we probably won't get this farm done now in this episode, but in the future episodes I'm gonna show you, and we're gonna continue here now. Let's do it. So that we're almost done cleaning this up actually. I have two things to mention. Firstly, why the hell is there no tool for sponges, because we cleaned out this entire area obviously with sponges. We had sand blades dividing this entire area into five wide columns, and then we've cleared them out with sponges. And if it weren't for the Haze 2 beacon, this would have taken a lot longer, because like, there's nothing you can mine these with. I'm assuming the sword is still the quickest, since it's a little bit faster, but why would they add blocks
not at a tour for them. That's really irritating. So yeah, we're almost done with this. We're gonna leave the base in order to actually mark where the farm is. And then we're gonna see which design we're gonna use, what we're gonna do here exactly. Because obviously, since there's no ocean, there's many spawn floors here, and we're not sure yet what we're gonna do. If we're also gonna dig out some kind of perimeter around this, and it will actually connect to the other one, because it's really close, but not close enough to still work with the other one. Or if we just settle, because this actually gets insane spawns. One reason is that... Can I get up there? One reason is that... Oh my god. Well, this is not good. One reason is that due to this being a survival multiplayer server, and the mob cap traditionally being very bad... Oh my god. On multiplayer servers, that some areas don't get mob spawns at all because it spreads so terribly, and there's like... It's solved very badly from the game. That the mob cap has been drastically increased, actually. And if you're working here for a while, we get like 900 guardians just swimming around. So many that it would actually lag the server out. So, considering those insane spawns without ever actually having lit up anything, we might not even do that. We might just go for it and like build the farm, see how it goes. If it's insanely slow after, we're gonna consider it, obviously. But like just like this, having this in the ground is also pretty cool. We might go and light up all the caves around here to get some effectiveness, or like significantly more effectiveness, but I'm not sure if an entire perimeter for this farm will be worth it. But we're gonna decide on that later. So yeah. Perfect, we dug everything out, just gonna fix the holes, light everything up, most importantly. And this is the update we have now on this area. Next step will take a while to actually build the farm. As I said, probably in some of these next episodes. But we've seen quite a bit. So yeah, let's get going. Okay, we have done digging out the entire perimeter for this, for now. If you can call this perimeter even. We actually had to extend the distance back there because this temple somehow generated weirdly and it was cut off like two-thirds of the way to here. So we had to dig out all of this, which is by far easier than removing all the water though. So we're pretty happy with this. We dug down to Y level 20 in order to have them fall far enough. The fall is gonna be from here. This is the frame we built. And yeah, with this final update, I shall end the episode. Stay tuned for the completion of this farm. I hope you liked it, and see you next time.